space. I'm gonna start off talking about, if you all just want to listen, I'll just talk about randomly my journey of unfoldment for me to get in this position to understand that thoughts create things, and that it's so important that we rewrite our story and think of new thoughts in order to change our reality. And you know that already, Miss Shane, because we sometimes go through patterns in life, like maybe in relationships, you know, maybe in a relationship you realize that, man, I've been through a lot of heartbreaks. Man, I've been through a lot of maybe narcissistic type people. Hey, baby. Hey, Israel. I've been through narcissistic people. I've been through the same type of jobs, maybe. I've been on the same type of job with the same messy ace people. Every time I get another job, I get into a group of people that are just so messy, and they make the job seem chaotic. Or, man, I keep moving. I move from this apartment to this home, from this state to that state, but yet I still feel depressed or something, like, right? And so when you get into those places in life, I feel like it's so important that we go through those places, because that's when you find out your true character. There's, since I've been soul traveling, that's why I haven't been around. Oh, okay. That's what's up. I appreciate that, because when you move, I move. So when we get to certain places in our life and we realize that our story keep repeating itself, it becomes a pivotal moment that we dare to do something different. We dare to see, wait, hold up, is this me? You know, like how we, you know, back in the day, you tell somebody, no, it's not you, it's me. But deep inside, you know that it was them. So when you get to this place in your journey, you're like, wait a minute. If it was them, and if it was them, and if it was them, and if it was that job and that relationship and in that situation, I'm the common denominator here. So what am I doing? Why am I attracting these type of things? And so if you come from a religious background, you might say, well, Lord, why me? Covered by the blood. You have a very beautiful soul, sis. Thank you for noticing. And so you'll say, Lord, if you come from religion, you'll be like, why me? Why me? And so that's the perfect place to be, because now you have asked the question, and from a religious standpoint, ask and ye shall receive, right? Knock and a door shall be opened to you, right? And so when I got to that particular place, I started paying attention to my behavior. I started being accountable for my decisions and my energy, or the signal that I was emitting energetically, right? And so it was like my attitude, my outlook on life, you know, my habitual thoughts, you know, my doubts, my spoken word, all of that I began to want to become accountable for, but it was just like the thoughts was just so many. It was just so great. In my physical body at that time, I was like tired all the time. I was like mentally drained and fatigued all the time, because my energy, I was at a low frequency. And so I discovered this here by when I began to change the way that I saw life. And the change the way that I did life also, you know, like when I say what I did with life, I mean like my diet, the things that I consumed in my mouth, you know, the things that was giving me life or the things that was making me tired. So I decided to go for the things that made me feel good, that gave me energy instead of making me sleepy after I ate them. With my ears and my eyes, the things that I paid attention to, like maybe the news, maybe the housewives and stuff, maybe the, you know, the little trap type music or whatever. Then I stopped listening to those things. I stopped listening to those things because they were taking up my time. And at the same time, they were decreasing my frequency, you know, like they were just making me, like, for example, I grew up in New Orleans, Louisiana. I'm in Arizona now. But in New Orleans, every time you turn on the news, you hear about a tourist, you know, getting robbed or something like that. You hear about downtown, you know, they, you know, stealing cars. You turn on the weather, you hear about the next hurricane that's coming. And so it almost there, it felt like I was just in survival mode, just trying to survive. And so when you constantly hear those type of things and pay attention to those type of things, you're on guard now. Now you're on guard. Now is all the windows locked? You gotta lock your door. You gotta pay attention to your surroundings. You're so busy paying attention to what's outside of you that you ain't got time to be doing no meditation. You ain't got time to understand what you really feel like. And so not only did I change the things that I was paying attention to, change the ways that I was eating, but I also changed my spoken word. You know, because I began to pay attention to my thoughts. Like I would think like, what if such and such would happen? And so then I would counteract that thought and I'd be like, you know what? Let's not get ahead of ourselves. That's not about to happen, you know? Thank you for this conversation. You're welcome, baby. So it's like, that's not about to happen. And so I begin to go general on these things, you know? I begin to go general on my thoughts, my way of behaving and thinking, like, right? Like, well, what if something amazing happened? Why you gotta think like that? Come on now, where this thought is coming from? And so I begin to really begin to like soul search, like, is this me? You know, like, you know, you hear sometimes people, you know, talking about relationships. Like I was on a live late last night and there was a lady on there and she was talking about how tired she was of dating. She was so tired of dating, and she reminded me so much of this thought process that I'm telling you about, not judging her. She said, I feel so tired of dating. I feel like it's a game. I feel like she was talking about a particular guy. She was like, I feel like he's never available when I call, and I feel like da-da-da-da-da. And so in my mind, I was like, oh, she got to change that program, because as a man think it, so is he. So she's thinking all of these things up, but she's in a precious moment in life that she don't realize she's a creator yet, but she's just creating crappy things for her physical reality. And so in the comment section, when she put that she felt like dating was crappy, even though I wasn't interested in the dating thing, I was supporting the person who was you know, doing a lot, because I'm not in the dating pool, sorry. Anyway, she was like talking about how bad it was, and I commented, I was like, you know what, I enjoy it. I feel like it's like a box of chocolate. And so you just don't know what you're going to get on the inside of every box, you know, each chocolate that you bite into, like, right? In so many words, that's what I said in the comment. And the host laughed and he knew where I was coming from, because he and I follow each other. But I was just trying to get this person to step up. You know, when I do consultations, do people be depressed and sad and because of their thoughts, because of where they are energetically, because of the outcome of their life? But it's always the person, the person that's doing, that's hosting it, or the consultant, or the therapist, or the pastor, or whoever it is, that's, or your inner being, okay, that has to stay in alignment, because we, during a moment of consultation, can't come down or stoop to your level if you're not into your inner being, like maybe your Jesus, maybe your God. God or source energy, whatever you reverence, ain't gonna come down from the throne, from its grace, or whatever you look at it as, to come and save you. You have to save yourself. So basically, it's not gonna come down and stoop to your negative way of thinking, your chaotic lifestyle, your your spoken word that is causing destruction to yourself. No, no, no. It has to stay in alignment and whisper those sweet nothings to you, like, but you're perfect, but all things are working out for you, but you are love, but you can be, do, or have anything that you want, but all you have to do is ask and ye shall receive, but the blessings of God is yea and amen, and it's according to how you feel. But oftentimes we be in that place where we don't understand that we're emitting a signal and we're getting everything that we want energetically. And so that's why I got into the place where I understood this. I began to do people watching even before I became a, you know, doing my consultations, a consultant. I begin to like people watch. I've always been an introvert, so I always understood energetically what was going on with people. But it's like I honed in on people watching, and during my spiritual journey, I became heightened in the ability to interpret dreams, to be more intuitive, to tap into some realms that seemed to be chaotic or scary to me in the beginning because I didn't fully understand them, and then I kind of was wobbling in the beginning of my journey. But with time and speaking to hundreds of people hereafter, I'm thankful and I'm happy that I'm in this position to be able to help other people. That's all. That's my truth. That's the only reason why I come forward on TikTok. Ain't for the views, ain't for the likes, ain't for the chicken, my eggs or whatever, ain't for the attention, because I would rather just be, you know, I would rather just be stealing no damn gut, but it's just heartfelt when I help other people. That's what it is. That's just basically me, the root of where I stem from. That is so true. If you knew my story, you inspired me, I'm thinking. Thanks for helping me in my strength and growth. Hey, Ruthie, how you doing, babe? You are so welcome. You are so welcome. But here's the thing. We all have a story. And so I look at it like this here. Being that we are in physical form, if we came forth to this realm, then there's some other realm or entity or place of being or knowing that we stem from. And so in that realm, I believe that we were pretty much consciousness, you know, subconscious and superconscious, all the Holy Trinity, right? Conscious, subconscious, and superconscious. And so with that being said, we knew all because we were all, but we came forth to have a human experience. So I feel as though we knew what our story was going to be like. Matter of fact, I believe that we created the story. Now, some people might believe that their story is really, really crappy. And that how dare you say that I created this here story because my mother left me under a tree. How dare you say that I created this story because my father abused me. Well, here's the thing, God. You were God then, so you had to have known all things. You had to have known this here, that the beginning of your story was going to be a little chaotic. But it was for the purpose of you experiencing yourself, experiencing your superpower, experiencing your tenacity, your will, your strength, your determination, your perseverance, to be able to get yourself out of the crappiest situations, just to remember again, that you are God. And so in that instance, of if that's the case, if you could relate to that of my thinking, because this is my thoughts, and I don't want to project my thoughts on you. But if that is the case, if you could just entertain that thought for a moment, you would further conclude that, okay, if I knew all and I created this story and I knew it was going to pan out to be that way, then I must have created or have the power to create my happily ever after. And that's where I come in at, because I come in teaching you the law of assumption. I come in teaching you, okay, if you rewrite that story and you get rid of the old subconscious thinking and create some new subconscious thought, then that's going to lead you to your happily ever after. Whatever your happily ever after is for you. My happily ever after was retirement. My happily ever after was early retirement, so that I can be, do, or think of, or create whatever it is with my time. Because I understand that time is me emitting energy. My time that I gave to the corporation for 22 years that I worked in was my energy that I was giving them. And so if you turn the word time backwards, you have the word emit. So when you're going to work every day, you're emitting some of your energy on to whatever it is you're doing. When you're spending time in a relationship with your partner, you're emitting energy, and that energy allows those relationships to grow, right? So I wanted to use my time that I was emitting to get deeper into subconscious thinking, go into other realms and be able to help other people, learn more tactics for meditation and mindfulness. So that way my energy that I emit is a spiritual ball of energy that I am emitting for the greater good, so to speak. And so that was really my biggest manifestation. And I don't want to say that that's going to be it, but I want to say that set the tone for me to get on the path that I wanted to be in, like right now. If I was at work, if I was still an employee, I'll be at work. I wouldn't be able to be free flowing with my energy right now to even emit or entertain the comments, right? So everything is purposeful in your journey, but you are creating it. That's how powerful you and I really are. And I'm just here to remind you of your power, or our power, so to speak, because we are not separate from one another. When I move, you move. So the people that will frequent this particular live are going to be connected to me in some shape or form, because they're like, I am like their subconscious mind. These are the type of people that's going to pass through, because these are the people that was asking. And since you're God asking, you receive the answer. And so some of the things that I'll be saying here will be kind of like aha moments, and they'll resonate with you because you were the one that was asking the question. God, meaning you, never asks itself a question that he or she doesn't know the answer to. How is that? Because God is tapped into the subconscious mind and the superconscious, where all information lies. If you know anything about the Akashic records, you better understand that. So you remember in that realm, subconscious and superconscious, every lifetime you've had, every experience you had, everything you thought of, it all still exists, because the energy, it is neither created nor destroyed. It's just simply transformed. So we transform those thoughts, or kind of like put those thoughts on the side while we come forth in physical form to have this so-called human experience. But everybody has that day, that aha moment that they return, so to speak, in this equivalent of like being the prodigal son in the biblical text. That they fall away, they go about and they want to do everything that they want to do, and they just want to say, oh, I only live once, and I'ma just, you know, enjoy my life, so to speak, or whatever the situation might be. But just like the prodigal son, there comes a moment where you turn back. You turn back around and you want to go home. Your soul is yearning at that moment for expansion. It is yearning for more. It gets tired. And so it sends you an indicator like a depression. It sends you an indicator like anxiety or sickness and dis-ease to remind you, you're off track. You're not paying attention to your inner being. No, do something different. You done did that already. No, change your diet. You know, you done ate crappy for too long. It's time to start being a little healthy. No, you done thought a little negative for too long. We're going to bring you some positivity in your life. No, you done been in religion too long. It's time for you to tap into spirituality and the deeper parts of your soul essence and learn a little bit more about yourself. Not learning about things outside of you, getting to know yourself, because to know yourself is really to know the God within. Hey, Taya Payne, thank you for being here. Thank you for your gems. You are so welcome. So I don't want to just be talking the whole time. I want you all to ask questions. Is there anybody out there in a place where they are dealing with an awakening right now that want to talk about that? Or better yet, you're in a situation with health and wellness. You want to talk about that? Hey, Miss Being Soul, thank you for being here. If you want to talk about that, whatever it is, thank you. Thank you for being here. Whatever it is that you have a question for, I'm here for an appointed time to answer those questions, and I want to do this here more frequently. I know for me, when I was in this place, you know, coming from religion to spirituality, I had a ton of questions. So I don't know. I don't know how y'all being shy out there. Maybe y'all some little introverts out there too. But I have a ton of questions. You know, it feels so refreshing to be able to talk to somebody. Maybe for me, it felt refreshing to talk to somebody that looked like me, that been through some struggles like me. You know, because I'm the same person that used to be a really like an overachiever. And now look at me, look at my username. I finally learned how to just be, because I used to always think doing would trump just sitting down and and not doing anything, like, right? When I came up, those of you who have my book or purchased my book or audio book, I appreciate the orders. that I got this week. I'm thankful. For those of you who purchased my audiobook, you know it to be true that I came up in a very strict religious background in, you know, my mother stayed in church, stayed in the ministry. And my father and my mother divorced when I was like 5 years old. And so when my daddy left, you know, I had, you know, other men in my life. I had all kind of amazing fathers in my life. But when my daddy left for me, I, as a little girl, felt like that was my fault, in a sense, because I was the baby, like, right? And I'm just sharing this while you come up with your questions out there, if you have any. So I was the baby. And so daddy would come, like, on weekends to visit me and my sisters. And he would always take us to Godfather's Pizza. To me, Godfather's Pizza was like the best. Even to this day, I could still taste the crust. They don't even have Godfather's Pizza that I out here no more. I guess they went bankrupt or something. Anyway, and he would take us to Godfather's Pizza, and he would slide underneath the table, you know, money for us. I used to always have money. Never had an issue with money. And that's why money has never been a problem for me manifesting, because I never created any resistance. Because I used to be like, you know, from age 5 up until, like, you know, I was like 18 years old, I always had a ball of money in my pocket, because daddy would drop off hundreds of dollars. And most of the time, I would just spend the money and just sort of at the candy lady place or whatever, you know, just snacking. Had the craziest diet because I stayed getting, you know, little Tootsie Rolls and Long Boys and nachos with cheese and chili and jalapeno peppers all day. That was my food, you know. Popeyes, 2-piece spicy white mashed potatoes and a jalapeno pepper. That was just me, a little candy snack, a little person. But my inner being, the little girl inside of me, she longed for her daddy. She longed so much for her daddy. She cried for her daddy so much. I mean, and I was religious, you know, and my mom kept us in church. I you know, I made peace and I found love in all the pastors, all the apostles and the evangelists for revival and their children. And so I was always surrounded by people that had faith, that believed in God, like, right? We have similar backgrounds. How did you deal with family after leaving the church? Okay, I'm gonna share that with you. So I was always in church. And so, but the little girl inside of me missed my daddy. She missed her daddy so much and thought that it was her fault that, you know, daddy left, because like I said, she was the baby. And so I began to hold in my pain, so to speak, my feelings, because, the, you know, big girls don't cry, is what they was telling me, right? And so it came to the point where the weekend visits were no more, and that really devastated me. And I was trying to be tough at the same time, holding on to my emotions, you know, but I wanted my daddy to be there. You know how, like, you have all of these other people that's playing the roles, but it's something about having that absent parent that you long for. You know how they say that absence really kind of creates a more fine, deeper longing, because your thoughts are spiraling. You're thinking about what they're doing, when are you going to see them, like, right? And so when the weekend visits became no more, I held that in, and I realized later in life that holding that in created dis-ease and disharmony with myself. Holding that in didn't allow that little girl to flourish and allow her spoken voice to be heard. Holding that in is the root cause of why many people have sickness and disease right now, holding on to things that happened to them in their programming state from when they were first coming in physical reality up until 7 years old, right? And so I held that in, and later on in life I began to experience, you know, all kind of, you know, sicknesses and disharmony in my life, and I never really understood why, and doctors never understood it, but later I understood it on the spiritual realm that I was the creator. Yes, being accountable, I was the creator of those things, because I was experiencing dis-ease in my inner being, and it had to come forth in physical form. And then I learned that healing my inner being was where the root was it off, and that's why I always talk about rewriting the story. That's why I always talk about the law of assumption and changing the thoughts that you have. That's why I always talk about forgiving. But really what I'm talking about is forgiving yourself, because we have people in physical reality that are grown men and grown women that's just walking around, but the little girl and the little boy is the one that's embodying that particular avatar. That's the one that's wilding out with the temper tantrums. That's the one that's really depressed. And so I, in my consultations, try to get to the root of that inner being and allow her to hear the words from her daddy, from her mother, from whoever it is that you think harmed you, but it comes from your voice because you're your own savior is what I teach. I teach that you need to tell your inner being the things that you wanted mama and daddy to say, because mama and daddy is not going to be held accountable by the way that you feel. Mama and daddy, part of the story is over, actually. You knew it was going to be like that when you came forth in physical form because you're God and you created this. Now save yourself, God. So that's basically what I do in my consultation. But as far as that question about how my family dealt with me leaving the church, you know I was a backslider. I'll say it like that. And my mother, being heavily involved in the church, I went to her when I was experiencing all of these thoughts and all of this change of thinking and wait, hold up, maybe it's me. Maybe I need to, you know, check into the God within me and this little girl in me, you know, because I was reading the Bible all the time. I read the Bible over 30 sometimes. Well, you know, well, under 18. Because I was always in church and my mama was so strict. She didn't want us to go nowhere and be with boys. I couldn't have a boyfriend and stuff like that there. So I'd be crying, either crying in my closet for my daddy or reading the Bible again to try to get a better understanding. And so I knew some things just didn't sit with me about like the kingdom of God being within me. I'm like, how is it in me? If, you know, if I got to pray outside of me, if I got to worry about hell and in heaven, which is outside of me, well, what could be inside of me? And so I, even when I was reading about the Hebrew Israelites, I was like, oh, these are some stubborn people. I mean, just imagine me 12, 13 years old reading about the Hebrew Israelites and all the things that they went through and how they was a sick neck people. That's how the Bible relates to them. And I would say, you know what? These people remind me of black people that I know in my life. Just reading the Bible about it. Everything I was stumbling on things that had me questioned. That had me questioning even when I was 12 years old. But at that time, you couldn't really question religion because you get popped inside your upside your head for that. You couldn't question God, so to speak, like, right? And that led me to a question because I'm like, why? Why you can't question God? If you don't know something, why you can't ask God a question? Like, what? And so I stumbled, and this is one of my favorite scriptures, like, about asking God why. And it says, the fool has said in their heart that there is no God. They are corrupt. They have done abominable works. There is nothing they can do with good. And so I would think about things like that. I would think about scriptures like, Son of Man, can these bones live? When they were talking about Ezekiel and the dry bones, like, right? And I'm like, wait, hold up. How he able to ask God questions? How he able to sit there and have a conversation with God like that? And it just took me, and you know, I had so many whys, and the people in the church would never answer my question. They'd be like, you just gotta believe, you know? And so I went to my mom when I was experiencing this dis-ease and this harmony and not understanding, and I just wanted really help with just my thought process, and my mom told me, just pray about it. Did you talk to Jesus? And I must admit, that day and that moment in time, I got angry with my mama and I told her, don't you tell me nothing about no Jesus. Because I'm standing there and I'm like, wait, hold up. All my life I've been in church. I'm talking about Sunday, Saturday. I'm talking about choir rehearsal. I'm talking about Bible study. I'm talking about being at even in different type of religions, Jehovah's Witness, non-denominational Baptist, because every time she moved to church, we had to move to another church. I was like, don't you tell me nothing about talking to no Jesus. I won't talk to my mama. Can I just please talk to my mama? And so I was telling her my thought process, and she pretty much felt as though, you know, I was leaving God, so to speak. And so I was like, you know what, Mom? I'm going to charge it to the game. If I'm a backslider, I got to go and I got to see with this life. If I'm going to go to hell, Mom, I'm going to need you to pray for me. And I'm going to take one for the team of going to hell because I feel like I'm going through hell right now. I don't have a daddy. I don't have a mama to talk to. I don't have nobody to go to. I don't know what this religious stuff got me feeling. I'm always not feeling good in my physical body. I'm always sick and stuff, and then the doctors don't even know what's going on with me. So I just kind of think I'm in hell already. So I want you to pray for me, and I'll be honest with y'all, I didn't speak to my mom for a while, for a season. Because like in the biblical text, I'd like to say it like this here, I was trying to be by my father's business. I was trying to see about what was going on with my inner being, my soul. I had to get me right. And I didn't care about being called no backslider. Them people in church, I've witnessed them. I grew up with the daughters of the pastors who used to wild out the most in church. Them people in church had their own issues, every last one of them. I knew all of their business because I was in the choir. I was a treasurer. I was the pastor's assistant. I was doing all kinds of things. I was an usher. I was a crack camera girl. I was just so everything. So I knew all of their business anyway. So I'm like, they can't judge me. And even if they judge me, I don't even care what they say. All I care about in this time and space is how I feel. And so I went on a spiritual journey, and I developed a discernment, an understanding what the difference was. And I concluded in that spiritual journey that all religions, because I studied them all. I ain't just go assuming and just reading people and just judging people. No, I went through the books and studied and got to know God from every religious aspect myself. From being a Seventh-day Adventist, seeing what they was doing over here, from being the Jehovah's Witness and what they believed and what was at the top of their tower and why do they believe that there's only 144,000, to numerology, to the Book of Enoch, the Dead Sea Scrolls, to the Law of Attraction, to the Law of Assumption, to quantum physics. I wanted to understand energy, frequency, vibration. I wanted to understand witches, devil, witchcraft, voodoo, whatever you want to call it. I done studied, I done researched it, the alchemy. I done did it all because I wanted to know, like they say in church, I wanted to know that I know that I know that I know. And if once I stood firm on my beliefs, and when I went in, I was good once I stood firm on my beliefs. And the thing about this journey for me is I went in, and they used to say in church, you know, you got to have this thing called spiritual buoyancy, where you fall down and you have the ability to bounce back up, like, right? So I took that same thought process, because religion was all I knew. I took that same thought process and I applied that thing to me exploring these different religious mindsets. It was like I was going to go in. I was going to find out what was going on with their religion, to learn the knowledge and wisdom that stemmed from it. But I wasn't going to get too deep in that I fell into it and became a Seventh-day Adventist, that I fell into it and became a Jehovah's Witness, so to speak. No. That was too deep for me. I needed to know the who, what, when, where, how, why kind of stuff, like, right? I needed to know how was it edifying the church. I needed to know what was in it for me. What was my role in it? And oftentimes what I found was that I was just a soldier. I was just a wretch undone. I was just a little G kind of God. And every last one of them. Or I was a God and then I ruled over other God, and it was going to be their season, because this is what the what do they call it, ones on the corner, the Hebrew Israelites, they would teach that, like, there would be a rule that I would be over them and I would enslave them and their wives and would suffer the way the so-called black people suffer. And man, I would tell you it was the crazy but yet most knowledgeable moments of my life that I sought what resonated with me, what felt good to me. And I digested a whole lot of it, and I kept and I stuck with the things that I digested and I resonated with, but I spit some of that other foolishness out and I left it. And that was equivalent to me not sinking, you know? I wasn't about to sink into it because I had already spent all of my childhood life running from one church to another church, doing what my mother say do as far as religious aspects were concerned, being afraid of going to so-called hell, of the so-called devil, or trying to love my enemy so perfectly so that I could be so perfect. But it just didn't sit right with me because some of my friends were far from perfect. Some of the people that was going to church you know, was slipping and sliding all of the time. Some of my friends were atheists and didn't even believe in God, but that yet they were blossoming in life, like they were flourishing in certain aspects of life, especially financially. And the people in church, they always, it was those three things. It was about relationships, it was about money, or it was about sickness. Because I was the usher and I heard and I was paying attention to everything those people were saying. And as a little girl, as an usher, hearing those things and other people would come back in church over and over, I would say, when I grow up, I don't want to be like these people. I'm going to find out what's going on here because something not matching up. These people are missing out on something. I don't know what, but I'm going to find out. I remember saying this to myself in my secret closet. Or better yet, when I was in church, when it was healing and deliverance time in the non-denominational church, and I had to stand there with the red little cover to put on the lady's legs, but when they fell out in the so-called Holy Ghost into the spirit, and I had to cover them up so nobody else would see, I'd be like, something just not right. And me being introverted at then, at that moment, being able to read energy, I would often tell somebody, she's faking. That's not real right there. Because that's how it felt to me. But I would always be hushed up to say those things. Like, she's over-exaggerating. She's not believing. I don't believe in that. And so I saw so many phony things. I saw so many crooked things there that it made me want to really go on this journey even the more. And even crooked, so to speak, things with the apostles, with the, you know, the deacons, the evangelists, you know, the pastors. The way that they talked when the members weren't around. Because, mind you, I was a little girl that would sleep over to their house, like, right? I would sleep over to their house because of their children who was doing their little things, like, right? And I would see the pastors and in their domain, like, without the robe on, without the congregation. I would see them, not in a judgmental way, but I would see them in their human form just being. And it just didn't add up. It just didn't add up to me. It didn't add up that pastor sometimes was sick too. Like, why would person that's supposed to be leading all the other sick people, why would they be sick too? Just why? I had so many questions. And so in my adult life, when I turned 18, all of them whys became my mission to try to figure out. And so that's why I feel like I have so much to share with others, because I try to figure that aspect of why out in the areas of mind, body, and soul. And this is my life. This is for me. It wasn't nothing for me to do this here for TikTok. This is just me living my life, just becoming a better version of myself for me, to leave a legacy on for my children at that time, to dare to be different from myself and my children, to break generational curses that stem from mindsets of people that just have a helmet on their head and they just refuse to take it off and they refuse to take and embrace knowledge, order, wisdom, and instruction for their life. And they refuse to read, even refusing to read the biblical text for themselves. Refusing to just think a new thought, you know, refusing to do something different. I didn't want to be like that person, right? And I didn't want to leave my children with that same stumbling block of thinking. So I wanted to create that dynamic that if mama could do it, I can do it too. If mama can see greatness inside of herself, then I can see greatness too. And it started with me telling my children, look, okay, we could go to church. You know, we could go to church. But guess what? I want you to go when you want to go. I want you to leave when you want to leave. I want you to digest what you want to digest. And I don't want you to do it based upon what mama said. Because oftentimes it just be the parents, projecting, oh, I want you to be a lawyer when you grow up. I want you to be a minister when you grow up. I want you to believe in God this kind of way, because if you don't believe in God this kind of way, I'm going to disown you. But that ain't even what unconditional love is. Unconditional love is you allowing some person, that person, to be able to be free-flowing with their energy, with their thought, with their way of being. That's it. And so, for me, that's what I did. And I also wanted them to pay attention to health and wellness. Okay, we could do this here, you know, supper plate type stuff that we do at church all the time. But I also want you to know about health and wellness. I want you to know what these exotic fruits could do for your body. I want you to know about herbs and stuff that heal your body outside of medication. I want you to know about your superpowers too. I want you to know that you're God. No, no, you're not a little G kind of God. You are God creating your own reality, because the human imagination is God. Yeah, that's the things that I want you to know. So everything that I didn't have when I was a little girl, I wanted to equip my children to have it. And so when my cup overflowed and was able to give my children those things, then my children passed me my phone one day and said, you know what, Mom? And this is when I was on Facebook. You know what, Mom? I think you need to go live and just talk to the people. Just say anything. I want you to see something. And so from that moment, I went live and the video went viral. And yes, I did delete the video because it got hundreds of thousands of people and I was still introverted at that time. But it's still, you know how they share it, so it's still floating out there somewhere in Facebook world. But the video went viral, and my son was saying, see, you need to talk to the people. I think you have a gift. And that's when I began to write the book. That's when I began to talk to people. That's when I began to go live more on Facebook. That's when I began to start doing consultations. But at that time, I was just freely just talking to people. I wasn't trying to get no kind of money or anything, but it just blew up. And so my time, you know, added on for me to start to do consultations and book them and log them. And then I started creating other things and other products. And that's what made me actually be here today, talking to y'all about it all, telling you all that I went through. And so if I can do it, you can do it, because you're just a reflection of me. Let me see. I was rambling. Let me see if I missed something up here. Let's see. Love and laughter. I appreciate you. Yes, sir. It was the same with my dad. Oh, empowered minds. We got a lot in common, huh? That's beautiful. That's beautiful. You are definitely my reflection. What a poor, if you don't, I'm near the Scottsdale kind of like area. Yeah. How are we supposed to know if we can't ask? You right about that. And so that was my first aha moment, because I always was inquisitive, and you gonna take that from me? You know, I always ask why. I always wanted to know why, just why. Like right now, even my today, like right, which is so simple. I have these hummingbirds out here in my yard, and I have a lot of them, and they're so beautiful, they're so perfect for me. But even with that, I'd be like, why? I wonder why. I wonder if they'll get used to me talking to them. I wonder why they're so defensive when another one comes around. And I've just been researching hummingbirds, because that's just how I am. I'm just inquisitive about everything. I want to know. I want to explore. That's how my mind works. And I'm okay with going down the rabbit holes of different thought processes, because I came here to explore as God in physical form. And I want to have, and now I have all of my time, and I want to make time to explore whatever it is that I want. And I want to see if it feels good to me. If it don't feel good, I want to have all of my experiences, is what I'm saying. And I believe that you should have yours too. And not be limited with your way of having your experience, because you are unlimited. You're a limitless being, you know? Once you open up your mind to that idea though. But you could stay up in your box, which is your limited way of thinking if you want to. And you could protect yourself in that box if you want to. But just think about it like this here. Inside of that box that you're in, if you step out of it, you understand that you're in a box. Meanwhile, you're in a boundless universe that's outside of that box, that's waiting for you to come out and explore it. And in the larger part of you wants you to come out of that box, because the larger part of you is longing for your expansion, for you to remember who you really are. Yeah. Yeah, right. Pack your clothes and sleep under the pew. Yeah, it felt like that. It felt like that. Like I had been given birth to on a front row pew. You know, I often be there because of your parents. You know, just saying that that's what we got to do. Right? Yeah. Hey, Twice Thomas. Hiding in religion. Yeah, pretty much. That's pretty much what we do. But I still feel, though, that religion is so purposeful for us. It's like our little caterpillar type state of being, like, right? It's so purposeful because it makes you really long for more. I know there's some people that gets really complacent in it, but still, they have adults. they longed for more. They thought the thought, they just did not own it. They just stayed there. Because some people have just stayed in power when they do it because of grandma in this great grandma church. And oh no, I could never leave great grandma church. Because I've been a treasurer for 30 some odd years. And they feel like they that's their place, right? But that don't mean that they didn't, those people didn't have the thought. That don't mean that those people are not going to evolve. And it might not be this lifetime for them because everybody has a certain season, so to speak, or a certain lifetime when they're going to become. If it's your season, be happy that it is your season and evolve for you because you heard the message. You heard your inner being saying, carry on, keep going. Oh, yeah, you're doing a good job. You're on the right path. You're perfect. I love you, you're worthy. You know, you just listen to your voice. Everybody else have their own little, you know, time clock. We all set our little imaginary time clock, so to speak, for when we chose to wake up. And nobody can push us. And then when you, if you think about it in language terms, when you try to go wake somebody up from their sleep just to go to work or just to get up for whatever it is, they'll get mad at you for making them get up earlier than what their time clock. The time clock was set for. And it's no different with this spiritual journey. And I don't feel like it is my business to force other people to wake up. I come here where I will allow other people to come free willingly to listen. But in my regular day, I'm not knocking on no doors on no Saturday morning saying, here ye, listen to your inner voice. No, and when I meet new people that don't know me, because I don't never tell people my physical reality of what I do, I just be sitting there and I just be smiling and I just talk to them about what's going on at that time. That's it. Or I make sure that the conversation stay on a positive end. If I hear them complaining and creating more chaotic things in their physical reality, I'll be like, huh, what was there anything good that came out of this day? Oh, come on. You could think a better thought than that, right? That's about as far as I go. I don't go trying to create another people's reality when they're not ready for it. You just that's not my job. That's not your job. Our job is us. Our job is saving ourselves. Our job is being accountable for our own energy, not other people. Because it ain't going to do nothing but kind of like sway you. Ain't going to do nothing but give you like limited beliefs or thoughts about that particular person. And at the end of the day, that person is just really you. That's you when you weren't evolving. That's you when you were in that place or state of being in your life. It's just reminding you of a realm that you just came out of. Enjoy where you are in your right now moment. Enjoy where you have become. Enjoy just being in this present time in space. With the mental, the clairvoyancy, the consciousness that you now have. Enjoy that. And don't worry about them other people. Mm-mm. Just like in the biblical text, it says, let the dead bury the dead. You know? So, anyway. Let's see. Let me go back up in here. We have the same roles in hearing you talk is so freeing. Yeah. That's beautiful. That's beautiful. Yeah, you was in church, you had all the roles too, you was playing. I didn't know what I was going to be doing from day to day. I didn't know, but I met a lot of apostles, a lot of bishops, a lot of evangelists that came in from town because we were in mega churches, we were in the small churches, and I got some kind of way. I always end up being the little assistant. You know, the person that gives up after the water. The person that see after the pastor, you know, after the pastor sweating and need to cool down and made sure that, you know, the pastor had all its bags after it left the stage, whatever. You know, just assisting them with whatever. Just being there for the pastor. Some kind of way, I was in the midst of it all and I was soaking up the everything that I was seeing, everything that I was experiencing. And I had my thoughts as a little girl, my thoughts. And they were spiraling out of control because they wanted more. They wanted to understand the whys. They wanted to pave the way for what I was going to do, be or have in my future. And I'm happy that I was in that position. I'm happy. I'm happy for everything that happened in my life. I'm happy for my unfoldment. I'm happy that my daddy left. I'm happy that I went in religion and I didn't like it. I'm happy that I got sick, because guess what? All those things paved the way for me to be in a position to help other people. I had to know what it was to not have my father around, because I had to know what love was and what love was not. I had to go in church and learn religion, because I had to understand spirituality and that there was a kingdom of God that was already inside of me. I had to experience some kind of little sickness or dis-ease or disharmony in my physical reality. How? Why? Because I need to be in this position to learn about health and wellness, so I can be in a position to not only heal myself, but heal my children from anything, to understand that life is supposed to be sick-free, and to be in a position to help other people increase their frequency and heal from their diseases and disharmonies. I had to have doubt. I had to have doubt. I had to be down diamonds at one point in my life in order to conjure up energy to learn what true faith is, what true law of assumption, to what true law of attraction is, and explore that too. See, sometimes we just want to experience God and the goodness of God and the grace of God and all of the good little presents that the church folk want, you know, when they stand up in the line of healing and deliverance. They only want the good stuff. But God is all. God is yin and yang. In the biblical text, it says God is the author and the finisher, the beginning and the end, the giver of life, and that which take it away too. So in order to embrace God, you got to embrace the totality of yourself. You got to go and experience this thing called life, and life is not going to exempt you from this thing called good versus bad. And in the biblical text, they talk about this in the book of Ecclesiastes, when they talk about seasons. There's a time and season for all things under the sun. A time to be born, a time to die. A time to laugh, a time to refrain, right? Oh, yeah. Let's see. Who is that? You are, and have always been, one that sees beyond the veil. Yeah, I have. Even as a little girl, like with my dreams. And dreaming and hearing my voice being called and seeing spirits inside of other people, astral projecting, which I thought was the craziest, scariest thing of my life. Seeing people like kind of like soulless, like their eyeballs wouldn't even be in their sockets, like, right? So I thought I was like tripping at one point and state in my life. I didn't understand what that was. I used to be shaking in my boots just to, you know, deal with people as far as spirituality was concerned. And I got to a point where I really just didn't want to be bothered, to be bluntly honest. Just didn't want to be bothered with nobody that had nothing to do with no spirituality, religion, or nothing, none of that, because I was seeing so much. To the point where I remember, like it was yesterday, my house, because I had started going deep into other realms and meditation, my house was really, really cold. For a season, it was really, really cold and eerie, like, right? And I was scared for a moment. I told one of my coworkers, this is when I used to work in the corporate building at the entry building in the utility field. And I would tell him it was time to go home, and I told him, I was like, dude, I'm so scared to go home. I'm so scared to go home. Now, mind you, I'm on a spiritual journey, trying to understand what these lucid dreamings and beings at that time was all about, trying to understand why I was seeing people in their orbs and their energy and stuff the way I was seeing it. And this guy told me, he's like, he was from religion, bless his heart. He told me, he's like, look, I want you to go up in there with confidence, and I want you to plead the blood of Jesus on whatever you think that is inside of that house, like, right? And so I was like over like the blood of Jesus, part of my journey. No offense to those who still use that thing. But I got to a point in my life where, hold up, this is about my blood, about renewing my blood. Because when my blood gets renewed, that's when my dormant DNA is awakening. That's when my dimethyltryptamine starts to activate. That's when I get my superpower. So instead of going home that day and pleading the blood of Jesus, it was about me. I used my authority, my spoken word, to get rid of that energy, that eerie feeling that had me scared, because I had created it. It was a fear that I had created from coming from religion that thought the things that I was doing now in spirituality were of the devil. See, when you have that fear of hell and devil and voodoo type stuff coming from religion, when you get over to spirituality, that be the very thing that you have to deal with. That be your skeletons in your closet that you have to deal with because you've been told it all your life. Not only that, but the scary movies that you don't watch with the Freddy Krueger and about the who they call it, what they call that man that comes, the Pope. Is it the Pope? The priest? The old man in Catholic religion that comes and put the little cross in the little holy water to cast out the demons. When you see them type of things going on, you think about those type of things, it'll scare you. It'll scare you when you get to your spiritual soul side because it's already deeply embedded in your subconscious mind. You remember, you're going to remember that fear because you created it, but you're your savior and you got to destroy it. See, that's why a lot of people, when they get to the spiritual journey, they're like, oh no, I think I'm just going back to church because it's so easy in church. You ain't got to be accountable for nothing in church. All you got to do is cast your cares upon the Lord because he cared for you. So many people in church had so many things in their Bible, and I've witnessed, I've seen these things. So many things in their Bible that they didn't want to deal with. All the way down to the electric bill. I'm going to just put my electric bill in the Bible and let Jesus take care of it for me. Not even want to be accountable for paying bills. Just want to give everything to God. But in my mind, and I was a little smart, but back then, I ain't going to lie, flipping the mouth, in my mind, I would think like, you know what? I don't think Jesus is going to pay your bills. I think you need to go to work. In my mind, I was like, you know, I don't think that makes sense. I think you've been a little lazy. You know, those were my thoughts as a little girl when I witnessed these people saying and doing these type of things. Because nobody in religion wanted to be accountable. But when you get to spirituality, you gotta be accountable. Because you realize that everything is you. Everyone is you pushed out. And you're so accountable because you done put together the fact that the Christ conscious one was a story about you becoming. You becoming and remembering who you are. You being crucified at one point in your life and you having the power to resurrect and save your own self. When you give mind to it, when you give thought to it, when you give accountability to it. Furthermore, the 12 disciples in the biblical text is every aspect of you. Hence, they have 12 zodiac signs or 12 personalities of you. It's a story about you dealing with you at different states of being that you gonna be in. And so that's why I always tell you, you gotta go within you and you have to be accountable for you because life is happening through you, not to you, and that you are God. You're God in physical form, creating. Let me see, let me get the bonies coming. Let's say, wow, mirror images, yes. How can I come on and ask a question? Oh, if you have over 1,000 followers, you can, but if not, you can't get in the box. Anybody that's over 1,000, you're welcome to come on. If not, you can ask questions in the comments and try to be as detailed. Just let me know you're about to ask if it's going to be more than one, you know, because you could only put so many characters in the box. Just try to be as detailed as possible and I can read that and I could just answer from the comments if you feel like doing the typing, but that'll be cool. Yeah, strong energy. Hey, the realest though. I like that name. Hummingbirds are messengers. Definitely. I believe that. I'm connecting with mine. I love my hummingbirds. I have the curtains open up so I can see them as they come. That's why I'm looking over there sometimes. Yeah. I used to feel wrong when ideas outside of Christianity resonated with me. Yeah, when you're tied to religion, you often do feel wrong because you're there and you're thinking of like a opposing thought, so to speak. You're thinking outside of the box. And so the box, getting outside of the box for you when you're in the box, it does feel wrong, you know, because you haven't explored the boundless universe. But I would encourage you to keep thinking those thoughts. Keep asking why, because that is creating energy or momentum for you to want to put your head over the box. And then one day you're going to try to kind of reach over the box, and maybe you'll dangle a little leg over the box, and then you just jump out that box. And then you won't be feeling no guilt or no shame, no worry, no wrong feeling, so to speak, about why you had that questioning thought. You'll realize you were asking the question because you knew the answer. And you put yourself in the box, knowing that you will one day deliver yourself from that same said box. Because you're God. Yeah.
Yeah. That was a good statement, Leonie. I think I'm saying that right. But I really want to learn more ways to trust myself. Yeah. So in order to trust yourself, you have to have a set belief or set foundation that I am trustworthy, that I am my own savior for myself, that on the lowest moments of my life, the darkest moments of my life, I was there for me. So yes, I trust me. And if it's deeper trust issues, then you got to go within to the little girl who probably, if it's deeper than you not being able to do it at that level, if there's a little girl inside of you who don't feel trustworthy because she went through something with her parents or went through something with the children that teased her at school and nobody stood up for her or defended her, you gotta let the little girl know that, hey, you can trust me now. Hey, I promise I'm gonna be here for you. Hey, I know you didn't have anybody during that season, but you did the best you could. Hey, I promise you that you got me. You got me to trust. And one thing about having me is that we're going to always be together for eons and eons, lifetime after lifetime. Because we're tied together through soul. I am merely the larger part of you. And so when you speak to yourself like that, so you can trust you, then everything else falls into play. It falls into proper order. And so sometimes we gotta go to the core. We gotta go to the core of understanding that, of understanding and knowing what trust really is at that level. So that little girl or that little boy can feel trusted, like she can trust. Because I do a lot of consultations, and a lot of people that have trust issues in any state of being in their life, that's what it really stems from. The people with trust issues, they'd be those same said ones that that maybe were molested. Maybe they, father left them, or mother put them underneath a tree, or just something that's triggered the trust as a little girl or a little boy, and then they just walked around with it, and they realized it later during relationships that they had trust issues. And they kept on having them in every relationship. They never sat down with the little girl or little boy inside of them. So the trust issues just kept on going. Kept on spiraling out of control. And so the only way that they're able to fix it is if they go back into the core. One moment, let's see. Okay. If they go back into the core or to the root of where it all stems from, and it all stems from all of it, it always stems from us. It ain't nobody else out there fault but us holding on to the idea of not feeling worthy, not being able to trust nobody, not feeling confident. It is our self-awareness. So it only has to do with self, awareness of self. Listen, oh, somebody was muted. Okay, thank you, Miss Being Told. I don't know what they were saying. So thank you. Thank you for taking care of that. Hey, Dion. Thanks for being here. Ask her about the book entitled The Power of Awareness. Oh, okay. That's in alignment with what I was just saying just now. I haven't read that book, though. Is it a good read? Flowing.
Hi, Floene. Thank you for being here. Hello, Goddess. How are you? Highness. I'm perfect, babe. Thank you. I feel perfect, Dion. Yes. I like that, the duck that visit lately. Oh, okay. Okay, you have ducks around you? That's what you're saying is being sold? Maybe I missed something, a comment or something. That's cool. They got ducks at the pond that I go to and frequent, and I watch them, you know. They got ducks and turtles. I'm around a lot more of nature out here than I was in Louisiana. So they got the coyotes. They got these big old hawks. They got all kind of birds and the hummingbirds. They got beautiful butterflies. Oh my God. And the bugs here are even more vibrant. They more, like all kind of fluorescent looking colors out here. But they have big backpacks on them. I don't know. They look a little creepy and they phase. Lord, they phase. They got lizards out here. I saw a lizard and he zoomed across the backyard so fast. That sucker looked like it had like alligator type skin on him. Not like the regular Louisiana lizard. And you know, when I saw him going fast like that, I thought about that little TikTok sound when they say, I'm fast as F boy, I'm fast as F boy. I mean, he was going. He was going. I just got up. I was like, wow. But yeah, I love the nature. I love that part about being out here in Arizona in the mountains. And I love the mountains themselves. Energetically, the mountains seem so peaceful. It's so much of a frequency. Like going back to religion, you know how Jesus often meditated on the mountains with the disciples and stuff? I feel like energetically that those was the mountains. Like the Christ conscious one was right there, like right. And the disciples, they was chilling right over there by that rock, because the energy of the mountains and the clear skies and the pulsating, electrifying sun, because it get really, really hot out here in the desert, is just so beautiful. Even the horses, they be having like certain roads you go down, you see like a whole bunch of horses, beautiful, beautiful horses, and they just running, and you'll see all the sand. It's like little sandstorms going, but that's them stomping or running or whatever. It's perfect. It's beautiful to me. It feels like heaven. It feels like heaven on earth. Yeah. Yeah, you are the box, inside and out. Okay, yeah, I never thought about it like that. I like how you put that. Yeah, I really like that. Have a beautiful day, love. Thank you for being here twice, Thomas. You too, babe. You too. I enjoyed your comment. Hola, how do we interpret our dreams? Hey, beauty. Well, always like this here. The dream is always about the dreamer. You know, sometimes we'll say that, you know, oh no, I gotta tell so-and-so that I had a dream. No, you don't. Mm-mm. Okay, you smile, some of that is done. Enjoy your day. Okay, thank you for coming, Dion. You have a good day too, babe. So, interpretation of dreams is going to always be about the dreamer. It's going to always be your inner being giving you a signal where maybe you have resistance in your physical reality or not, like, right? So, even in the biblical text, they'll tell you in a dream, in a vision of the night, when man sleeps and slumbers, I give them their orders and their instructions. That is equivalent to telling you where you have some resistance at. So, like, if you have a dream, for example, that you're, like, running from something. So, you're running from a part of yourself, is what it's saying. And so, when you're running, and if you're afraid that you're running, you're afraid of whatever it is that you're running from, is telling you by the emotion that you're experiencing in the dream that in your day, in your physical day, that there is something that you have fear of. And if you don't clear this resistance of fear, that fear, the energy, the feeling that you're feeling, it's going to grow and it's going to allow something to manifest in your physical reality. So it's kind of like giving you a signal of where you are energetically as it pertains to whatever it is that's going on in the dream. And you could correlate all of that and bring it to your physical reality. So to unfold those type of dreams, you find out what it is that you're sitting there in the daytime, afraid of, running from, don't want to face. You know, I don't care who's in the dream. Like, you know how they say, oh, I had dreams of fish and all of that, but that means somebody pregnant.
But it's your dream. It is about you manifesting, because you are the operant power there. You manifesting new life in your simulated environment, because you as the operant power are running the show of everybody else. You're manipulating the energy through all of them people. You're thinking everything up to be the way it is. Just like you sit there and say, as God, I knew that was going to happen. How did you know? Because you thought it up already. When something happens and unfolds in front of your eye, you have confidence in knowing that you knew it was going to happen because you are God. You look at certain people as if they're not going to love you because of something deeply rooted inside of you. And then when they don't love you, you know that they wasn't, because guess what? The whole while you created that character to perform that way, and you'll move it. Because every time you gave them thought, every time you looked at them, you gave them a role to play. This is why in the biblical text it teaches you to speak those things that be not as though they were. It was to always teaching us how to look at people through the eyes of God, or situations through the eyes of God being whole already. This is why all of the biblical text parables, when Jesus came in the New Testament, which was the subconscious way of thinking, why it was saying, you're healed, go in faith. You know, I don't see it that way, so to speak. Peter not being able to stand on the water because he didn't see or believe himself to be in that state of being. Because it's always according to your belief, or in the biblical text it says, according to your faith, your sins are forgiven, or you are whole or not. It's always with according to your faith or your thought, your mind, your subconscious, your faith, your human imagination, the seed of your soul, the way that you view the world, your habitual thinking, your spoken word. It was always according to you. And so we have this power, and we use this power, and you know it to be true, because everything in our life, whether it is good or not so good, we thought it up. And so if a person is a person that sits there and worry about money and not being able to pay their bill and fearful of getting evicted, and then they get evicted, they thought that up. They're receiving, because they ask. It's almost like I like to look at things like in a sense of playing an imaginary game where your inner being can't really speak English, so to speak, but is looking amongst us all according to how we feel, and giving us everything energetically we're emitting based upon the way we feel and the things that we're thinking, right? And so if you pay attention to how you're feeling and what you're thinking, you'll clean that up if you know that your inner being is pretty much giving you the blessings of God based upon that. Because if it feels you feeling depressed or feeling out of luck, or, you know, down on yourself, state of being sick or tired, or sick and tired at a point in time, it's like your inner being saying, give her more. Because the blessings of God, yea and amen, she's putting out a signal, give her more. If you think about it like that, you'll thrive. You'll change those thoughts quickly. You set an appointed time, like if something, what we would call so-called bad, was to happen to me in my physical reality, I'm talking about bad, where I would maybe want to cry or something like, right? I'll allow my time to release that energy. But in my mind, I'm like, okay, I gotta get it together, because I know my creation power. I release and I get back. Because you find that if you don't get back, then you'll be just like them other people who didn't get back, and they grieved and they wanted to jump in the grave or kill themselves or go fight somebody and slash some ties. Just like, for example, grieving. They'll say, oh, it come in threes.
Why is coming in threes for you? Why one ain't enough? Why is it three? Because you sat down there and created two more? Because you was in the dump for that long, in the spiral that long, that you created two more times? That same situation happened? So now you God in your physical reality. Hey, move, how you doing, babe? Thank you for being here. You God in your physical reality. And you just sat up there and you done killed two more people. Because you sat there and you mourned and you were in a depressed state of being and you were in a fearful state of being. But you use a little silly little saying like to cover up the fact that you just destroyed God, and you use that saying and say, well, they say it come in trees. Really? Really? Okay. Yeah. I knew you from Louisiana, love the accent. Yeah, I can't see behind it. They stand out now, I guess, especially since I'm out here around a bunch of strangers. Hey, Blue, what you hashtagging? Blue Strip? I see you, babe. Yeah. Yeah, hey, I moved. But I see, thank you. You're so welcome, babe. But yeah, that's just how the game of life goes. You could accept it or not. But it ain't gonna change it. Like, you can accept gravity or not, but you ain't gonna just go floating around, you know? It is what it is. You could fight it and create resistance from it, and you could even subconsciously create ideas where it is not true. But it'll still be evident in your physical reality that you are creating to an extent. Yeah, you could give your power away to somebody else if you want to, baby. It's fine. You have eons and eons, lifetime after lifetime of doing this. You can never get it wrong. You could only delay your own unfoldment, you know? You could only delay your own unfoldment. So it always going to start and end with you, because you God, you the author, and you're the finisher of your own faith, of your own assignment. And so you didn't give yourself no deadline. Even if you gave yourself, you could always rewrite your story at any given time. You could change the narrative at any given time because you created it. You could transform it. You could destroy it. You could give up the goat today and just go on to another realm or jump into another avatar body and start all over again. It's totally up to you. It's totally up to you. So any questions out there as I wrap it up? I really wanted to just do an hour. Oh my goodness, I went over an hour. But if any of you out there want to book a consultation in private instead of on this here platform, you can do so on my website. My link is in my bio here on TikTok. And it felt so refreshing talking to each and every last one of you, even the ones that didn't ask a question. I still believe that you carried on because part of this message did resonate with you. And I'm hopeful that maybe next time that you ask more questions and somebody will get inside of the box and ask questions about spirituality, about consciousness, about, you know, quantum jumping maybe, about self-love, what it is and what it is not, because it's not about anything in the materialistically and the physical reality. Is an inner self-concept type work that takes time to do thought by thought, because you have to reprogram your mind from the old way of thinking of yourself, of viewing yourself, of thinking those habitual thoughts that was your own stumbling block of why you're not having the healthy relationships that you want, or not getting the good job that you want, or attracting the right amount of money that you want. It all starts and begins with you. Yeah. Hey, Tori Rose, thank you. You caught the end, and hopefully you'll catch the beginning next time. Yeah, I'm going to start doing this more frequently at 10 a.m. Mountain time, so you could adjust your clock for our time. Right now, just to let you know, it's 11:35 a.m. here in Arizona, so at 10 o'clock a.m., my time, mountain time, I'll start doing this here live consultations, and I'll talk to people
about their situations. Today, I guess being today that it was the first one, I kind of wanted to share a little bit about myself. But next time, I'm not going to just be going into about myself. I'm going to make sure that, you know, some people who want to have many consultations live, that they're here, and so that they can ask more questions so we can get in depth with, oh, you're in the same mountain time too? Perfect. So we can get in depth with some core issues, because I really believe that, and this is wholeheartedly why I want to do it, I really believe that there are some people who could benefit by just hearing it. You know how sometimes we're like, oh, I'm good, I don't need nothing, life is just perfect. But then when another person begins to talk about their story and the things that they're going through, it becomes an aha moment, like, oh, wait, I'm going through that too. I've been going through that for a long time. So let me see what you're going to tell her, because of whatever she's telling her, maybe I can do that same thing. And then at the same time, not only am I helping that one person that's talking about it, but then I'm helping the other person that's going to, you know, secretly do it on their own time, the same way or the same thing that I'm telling that one person. And that way, so many people are being blessed at one time. So don't be shy, y'all. Don't be shy. Ladybug, thank you for being here. Don't be shy. So tomorrow at 10 a.m., if you're available, come back and visit me on my live. I needed to hear what I got, but I'll be back. Okay, I'll see you tomorrow, baby. This video was from my heart to yours. Y'all be blessed and have a good day. And remember, you God. Go on and create something out there. And make it good, baby.